You might be wondering why it's taken us so long to give the Samsung S25 Edge the iFixit teardown treatment. Was it the new strain of COVID that took out half our team? Or maybe it was the Switch 2's launch that torpedoed every other device that was on our calendar? No, it was neither of those things. The truth is, this device is so thin that it just fell through the cracks. In all seriousness, this phone is extremely thin. At just 5.8mm thickness, Samsung clearly felt that a titanium frame was a necessity to maintain modern-day durability standards. But this isn't the first time we've seen a phone this thin. In fact, as Michael Fisher points out, the last time we had a phone this thin was in 2016 with the Moto Z. That phone was even thinner, and the frame was made of aluminium. So let's dive into the new ultra-thin phone to see if we can find out what Samsung sacrificed, if anything, to temporarily obtain the title of world's thinnest consumer smartphone. Just like past Galaxy phones, the way to the internals of the S25 Edge is through the back panel. That means I need to apply heat to the back panel and use the anti-clamp to open up a gap and cut away the glue. It's the same familiar process we've seen on Galaxy phones for ages. The back plastic finally comes away, giving me access to the wireless charging assembly. The 5 screws and flex cable arrangement is pretty standard for Samsung phones, as is the layout of components underneath. The interconnect cables between the mainboard and daughterboard are a familiar sight too. To get access to those cables, I need to remove the SIM tray and lower speaker assembly first. Now, if you're wondering where I got all these tools for this teardown, you'll find them all in our ProTech Go toolkit. It's got everything I need for this job. And just a reminder, when you pick up one of our toolkits, you're not just getting a great toolkit with a lifetime warranty, you're helping us make free repair guides, produce teardowns like this one, and fight for the right to repair. We seriously couldn't do this without your support, so thank you. Let's remove the screws securing the USB-C port and then disconnect the battery and the flex connectors from the mainboard half of the device. With these disconnected, the USB-C port can lift out. We love modular ports. With those connectors out of the way, we're once again treated to the sight of Samsung's solution to battery removal. It's elegant in its simplicity and highly effective. First used in the S25 series, this battery-hugging wrapper makes battery removal an absolute breeze. The battery in the S25 Edge is rated for 15.21 watt-hours and measures just 3.54 millimeters at its thickest point. That's compared to 19.4 watt-hours in the S25 Ultra, 19 watt-hours in the S25 Plus, and 15.6 watt-hours in the base model S25. I want to remove the entire upper assembly. And to do that, I'm just going to go ahead and remove all the screws around the upper speaker assembly and disconnect any flex cables still attached to the mainboard. That includes the selfie camera, the millimeter wave antenna, and lastly, the screws on the camera. Sure enough, that releases the board and the camera assembly in one go. And as is Samsung's way, the connectors for the camera assembly are on the reverse side of the board, meaning any camera repairs require the removal of the mainboard. As for the cameras themselves, like most camera upgrades on the market today, most of the improvements are going to come from the new AI features like AI upscaling, though we expect Samsung won't go for a moonshot of an upscale this time around. The 200 megapixel main camera is the same as the one we found in the S25 Ultra. The ultra wide camera is the same 12 megapixel found in the S25 Plus, and the telephoto camera is completely gone due to size constraints. Moving back to the main board, while clearing the thermal paste off the SoC, I was surprised to come across what appears to be a graphene thermal pad. If you're performing this repair and intend to reuse the thermal pad, save yourself the hassle and clean the thermal paste off with something much more loving than a blunt instrument. Underneath the pad, we have more thermal paste surrounded by thermal putty. All of this will be difficult to replace if you don't preserve all the materials, at least until someone provides a pre-cut thermal solution that fits this form factor. Putting the same powerful SoC in a frame 25% thinner comes at a cost though, as GSM Arena's thermal tests reveal the Edge throttles performance sooner than other Galaxy S25 phones. Removing the screen, which, as you can see from the towel under my hand, I had to heat to a few degrees below what's needed to achieve atomic fusion, is not the easiest thing to do. It's adhered pretty heavily to the frame, which will make screen replacements a little more difficult than it needs to be. But under that screen, we can see the other major thermal component, the very wide but very shallow vapor chamber that is dissipating heat away from the SoC and through the screen. Dissipating heat through screens is neither new nor novel and is a common vector for heat management in portable devices. On the CT scan, we can see the other common vector to dissipate heat, the battery. Batteries are, for all intents and purposes, used as a heat sink, but obviously there are limits to this. As batteries get warmer, their chemical composition becomes compromised, so there's a trade-off between using the battery to keep the device cool and preserving the battery's longevity. With everything out, we can put that titanium frame to the test, and it's surprisingly strong at resisting bends across one axis. But with the internal components removed, the limits of that strength becomes apparent. It withstands the fold test, but fails miserably on the twists. So maybe avoid twisting your phone in any unusual ways, and you should be fine. As for repairability, our tests show that parts pairing still remains absent in the Galaxy line of devices, and the improved battery removal process is a major repair win. However, there is an awful lot of work left to do. Samsung still has a lackluster offering of spare parts and repair guides,
and the lack of clips on the display and rear panel complicates both disassembly and reassembly.
All things considered, we've given the Samsung S25 Edge a provisional repairability score of 5 out of 10. We'll adjust the score if Samsung decides to level up its repair game and address the shortfalls we've identified. The ball is very much in their court.